feminine. That's what Galahad's searching for. And of course, you can't call it Mary Magdalene in a monastic tradition in the mid-13th century, so you call it the goblet. But the goblet actually is, that goblet is actually the image of the curves of the sacred feminine, right? That image of Mary, who's Magdalene, right, who's not present. That's the Holy Grail tradition. Go deeper, just kind of play with them, just playing with that on the outside for a second, just give you a context for it, right? Maybe the most popular book, you know, which didn't actually talk accurately about the tradition, but actually touched into that energy, was the Da Vinci Codes. Remember, that was around a couple of years ago, two, 3 years ago, right, by Mr. Brown, right? So that book was basically a later recension in popular terms with a lot of novelesque, but it was playing with this tradition we're about to talk about. It was about that. It was about that precise thing. Let me give you a third vision. For those of you, I don't know if there's anyone here from Utah, but if there's anyone here from Utah, right, so you may be familiar, there's a strong Mormon church in Utah, right, and at the center of that church, there's a tabernacle, and in that tabernacle, there's a Holy of Holies. Now, what the church did with it, I take no responsibility, but the source of the tradition, what Joseph Smith and Brigham Young were playing with in inner Mormonism at its very, very source. How something plays out is a whole other story. But its source was this precise tradition we're about to talk about. Right, we're about to talk about the mystery of the Holy of Holies, the mystery of Sanctum Sanctorum. And with that, maybe we'll begin. And I'm going to begin in a way which is the way we do it in the... Please? Absolutely. So, maybe the way in is the way we'll try and do it is the way we actually do it in the tradition. Meaning, I'm not going to do it as a kind of integral map, although I'm madly in love with maps and I love to dance in maps and we'll get to dance there. But I want to do it actually from the inside, meaning where association leads to association. How does a baby think? The baby thinks through association, right? One word to another word to another word. There's a rush of associations. So paradoxically, mystical thought works the same way. It moves through associations. It's a different kind of, it has its own linearity, its own line, but the line isn't, you know, the kind of structure of an essay. It's the structure of an idea giving birth to an idea, giving to an idea. But at the end of it, right, we have a whole world imagery, we have a whole world view. We're going to be able to take that together back to Big Heart and then into this whole, you know, hopefully, you know, mind-opening, heart-expanding, and also evolving. We want to evolve the teaching tomorrow where we use all this. So let's begin. So when we say the Holy of Holies, what are we talking about? What's the Holy of Holies? Like, oh my God, right? What's that? Right? Holy of Holies. So the Holy of Holies is a technical term which refers to the inner sanctum in the temple. Okay? The inner sanctum in the temple. Which temple? The temple in Jerusalem, which was destroyed a couple thousand years back. Right? The temple here, right, in Utah is a kind of relationship, in relationship in some way to that temple. Right? And there's an inner relationship, but the core of the temple is this temple in Jerusalem, which has an outer sanctuary, and it has kind of an inner sanctuary, and then another inner sanctuary, and then the most inner sanctuary, the inner sanctuary of the sanctuary, which is the Holy of Holies. And as you go further and further and further inside, more and more clothes, as it were, more and more garments, right, are removed until we get to kind of the naked presence of divinity, which is in the Holy of Holies. In the Holy of Holies, what's inside is an ark. It's an ark. Now, Western civilization that we're all part of, Raiders of the Lost Ark, that's the ark. That's what that image is. That's precisely the image. These are actually the cultural images of our society, but they actually remain invisible to us. Remember Thucydides, you know, talks about, you know, the Peloponnesian Wars, right? When words lose their meaning, culture collapses, right? So in other words, when we talk about Raiders of the Lost Ark, and it just becomes Indiana Jones, we're in trouble. With all due respect, blessings to Harrison Ford. I think it's being playing again in the theater, if I believe, around someplace. It's kind of happening again, so we're in good time. But Raiders of the Lost Ark is the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies in the temple. And that has a kind of inner, that's an inner mystical tradition. So we're not now in the map, we're in the territory now. You feel what I mean, the difference? It doesn't feel like we're now in it, we're going to go into the territory. So this ark has above it two cherubs, C-H-E-R-U-B-S, Anyone ever met any cherubs? Anyone here know any cherubs? Met a couple of cherubs along the way?
Used to be my name, Cherub.
Cherub? Oh my God, this is your teaching.
I was kind of wacky.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Right? I'm not sure I would name my kid Cherub. We could work with that later. I know there's a few psychotherapists here. We can kind of address that. So I'm not sure I would get them. But Cherub means, anyone ever heard the word?
Yeah.
And a cherub? Right. Go ahead.
It's an angel.
So it's called an angel kind of 1,000 years later, but the original image for cherub are these two cherubs that exist in two places in this old sacred text. They exist at the entrance to the Garden of Eden, and they exist atop the ark. Go ahead.
Guardians?
They're kind of these guardians. They're actually two faces, male and female, above the ark. And here's the text. The text reads, and I'll read you the original text with your permission, I'll translate it. It says, there's shnei kruvim mi'al ha'aron. There are two cherubs above the ark, mi'urin ze b'ze, who are sexually intertwisted one with the other. That's the image of the cherubs above the ark. That's actually its source. That's where it comes from. So the actual sacred image, and if you have a kind of Eastern sense of yab-yam, you know, an Eastern sense of kind of, you know, images of sacred sexuality, the actual image in the ark above the temple are these sexually intertwisted cherubs, mi'urim zebzeh. That's the image of the cherubs, this masculine and feminine cherub. And that is in the inner sanctum of the temple, in the place above the ark, and in the space between the cherubs. They're intertwisted, but there's a kind of space in between the cherubs. That is where the divine voice emerges from. It's a pretty powerful image. It's a pretty powerful image. V'no'adeti lechami bin shnei akruvim. I will speak to you from between the cherubs. So the cherubs are sexually intertwisted above the ark, and there's an image of a kind of divine voice, right? Meaning, right, all that's sacred, meaning my authentic self, right? Meaning, you know, ultimate pure spirit, meaning pure spirit incarnate in human form, right? Meaning all that is, right, that is real in your original face before it was born. All that comes from, right, this place between the cherubs. So it's a strange image. And all I want to do for now is just throw out the image and not address it. Let's just talk in front, just two or three images, okay? That's image one. Got image one? We're going to refer back to that. Image one. We're going to call that the cherub image. We're going to have time to come back to this. Remember, Eric, right, in the space between the cherub, that's your phrase. We're going to come back to that time and again. The space between the cherub, there's this kind of divine voice that emerges. And up to now, we've said absolutely nothing. We have no idea what we're talking about, okay? Well, let's just keep going, okay? That's image one, okay? And in a mystical teaching, right, which is why Western teachers don't do it in a didactic way, because we have a kind of consumer society, and if people aren't immediately satisfied with something, that's not how mystical teaching works. You got to kind of step into it, you know, kind of delay gratification, right? And again, that's hard for us to do. You know, when I say us, I mean all of us. I'm also raised in America, you know, and then in Israel, and a consumer, right? Could he just get to the point already? No, that's not how mystical teaching works. We layer it. We layer it, and it's a transmission teaching. And so it's not about holding that little idea, it's about kind of, and in the end, this kind of gorgeous picture emerges, okay? So here's the second source. That was source one, cherubs, and a reading of, you know, how the cherubs kind of play in the world. Source two, I want to read the source to you. Well, I just jotted myself down to remember to have the source, but I think I can read it from memory, but I'll give you the approximate, I'm going to actually, with your permission, I'm not going to read it in the actual Aramaic, I'm just going to give you an approximate English version of what it says. Here's what it says. There's a debate between the masters in the Talmudic study hall, okay? And everything we're doing is going to be the source of the Templars. This is the source of the entire Grail image. This is the source of this later Da Vinci Codes thing. This is the source of the Masonic lodges. Everything comes from this. The whole Mary Magdalene tradition, the entire temple, it's all from this. This is the original pure teaching, which is gorgeous beyond belief. So in the original study hall, there's this debate between the masters about the following case. They talk about legal cases. You need a little bit of a Talmudic sing-song. You know how to do the Talmudic sing-song? It's actually very easy. It's kind of like a Jewish yoga, okay? You know, does anyone here do yoga? Do people do yoga? Anyone does yoga? Yeah? Well, we have a much easier version. That's okay, Aaron. It's just we're not so flexible. So you do like this. If everyone could just kind of hold out, I don't know, your left hand. Hold out your left hand. It's really easy. I promise, okay? Hold out your left hand. Then you get. Put a thumb up, and go, yeah, try it, yeah. That's the whole thing, we're done. That's it, that's Jewish yoga. It's really simple, it's easy, you don't have to twist, move, you know, our friend Sally.